This video was made possible by CuriosityStream. Watch thousands of high-quality documentaries and get access to my streaming service Nebula using the link in the description. 50 years ago, giant hovercraft were the pride of Britain. They were a new kind of machine that could go almost anywhere, on land, water, or just about any other surface. And they were fast, capable of reaching 130 kilometers an hour. The largest could transport 60 cars and as many passengers as a jumbo jet. These giants once promised to revolutionize the way we travel, but today they've all but disappeared. To understand what made hovercraft so revolutionary, consider that they're not like any other vehicle. In fact, they share more in common with aircraft than boats. That's because hovercraft are essentially airborne. They work using the principles of lift and thrust. To lift off and hover, fans trap a cushion of air, while propellers generate thrust to move forward. And what it all means is that friction and water resistance are significantly reduced, allowing a hovercraft to hit speeds well beyond that of any ship. But speed isn't the only advantage, because no other vehicle can match a hovercraft's versatility. Out at sea, in shallow water, on ice, or in a swamp, they can go where no other vehicle can. Where there's no harbor, a hovercraft can simply crawl out of the water where a ship would run aground. Hovercraft were a brilliant innovation, and in the 1960s, a hover transport revolution seemed just over the horizon. When the first hovercraft debuted in the summer of 1959, it stunned the world, as it appeared to almost magically float over any surface. Its designer, a brilliant British engineer named Christopher Cockerell, wasn't the first to dream up the idea of a hovercraft. But modern hovercraft wouldn't be possible without Cockerell's key innovation called the momentum curtain. Earlier attempts at building hovercraft involved blowing air into an open hull, which didn't work very well and required a lot of power. Cockerell's innovation was to direct a ring of air towards the outer edges of the hull, trapping high-pressure air, which allowed the craft to hover much higher off the ground. In 1959, Cockerell and two others piloted the first practical hovercraft all the way across the English Channel. But it would take another key innovation to truly unlock the hovercraft's potential. In 1961, another British engineer proposed fitting the craft with a flexible skirt, which would allow it to hover much higher off the ground to better handle uneven surfaces. With the flexible skirt, hovercraft could become much more versatile machines. And it sent British aircraft builders racing to develop their own designs. Almost overnight, the first small-scale hovercraft transport services began popping up throughout Britain. In just a few short years, hovercraft would go from small prototypes to enormous craft that could carry hundreds of passengers. By the mid-1960s, a hovercraft craze had swept the world, and countries like the United States and France poured millions into their development. But the British were at the forefront, and the leading company in the world was Saunders-Roe. They had not only built Cockerell's original prototype, but also a series of civilian and military designs. And in 1963, Saunders-Roe set out to build a new kind of hovercraft, one that would be four times larger than any previous design and built to compete against conventional ferries. On the English Channel, a ferry needed about an hour and a half to make a crossing. A hovercraft would cut the trip down to just half an hour, allowing for twice as many daily crossings. The new giant would be designated as the SRN-4, and it would operate more like an airliner, with a crew that would include a captain, flight engineer, and navigator, along with a deck and cabin crew of 11. In standard configuration, it would carry 30 cars and 254 passengers, or could be configured for 609 passengers. No one had ever attempted to build a hovercraft this large. The engineering and economic risks were enormous. The The world's largest hovercraft debuted in the summer of 1968, with service connecting Britain and France on the English Channel. On board, high-profile guests included Princess Margaret and Christopher Cockerell himself. Passengers marveled at the all-British achievement as the 165-ton machine built up speed. But what no one yet realized was that the SRN-4's rubber skirt was literally tearing apart beneath them. Attachments designed to contour waves were damaged or torn right off by rough seas, sending repair crews scrambling to replace them after almost every trip. And just 3 days into service, a large wave damaged the craft, putting it out of commission for nearly a week. And it was really just the start of problems. Crossings were regularly canceled due to mechanical issues like hydraulic and gearbox failures. But an even bigger issue was the weather. The SRN-4 was rated for waves of just 2.5 meters. And on the English Channel, it didn't take much to stir up those kind of conditions. In its first 3 months of service, more than a third of scheduled trips were canceled. The debut hadn't gone well, and in October of 1968, the SRN-4 was pulled from service altogether to undergo extensive modifications. Unreliable and seemingly unsuitable for open water travel, the future of large passenger hovercraft was in doubt.
Next time, cross the channel the streamlined way. It's fast. It's got style.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a beautiful day. We'll be traveling at 60 miles an hour, and we're expecting to cross in just 35 minutes.
Despite the disastrous debut, cross-channel hovercraft proved to be incredibly popular with the traveling public. And by the time the SRN-4 was put back into service, many of the earlier issues had been solved, and the skirt had been redesigned to better withstand waves. By the mid-1970s, there were two carriers operating iconic hovercraft on the English Channel. And they could barely keep up with demand, with trips fully booked weeks out in advance. But there was still a problem. Neither carrier was actually making money, because the SRN-4 burned 1,000 gallons of aviation-grade fuel every hour, and maintenance costs were astronomical compared to conventional diesel ferries. To offset high operating costs, both carriers had to modify their hovercraft to increase passenger and vehicle capacity by widening and lengthening their hulls. By 1978, the largest hovercraft could carry 418 passengers and 60 cars. The increased capacity helped make giant hovercraft more competitive, and by the end of the decade, hovercraft were carrying nearly a third of cross-channel passenger traffic. But as the 1980s approached, large civilian hovercraft would face a challenge that no engineer could solve. If iconic hovercraft were in operation today, they'd still be the fastest way to cross the English Channel. Faster than conventional diesel ferries or high-speed catamarans introduced in 1991, faster than even the Channel Tunnel, which opened in 94. But it wouldn't have mattered. The hovercraft as a form of transport really was doomed from the start. In the early 1960s, they had captivated the public's imagination with their incredible speed. But that speed came at the cost of just about everything else. Compared to conventional ferries, hovercraft were less reliable, less efficient, less capable in rough weather, and less comfortable. And it meant that by the end of the 1960s, excitement over hovercraft had largely worn off, and Britain's once booming hovercraft industry fell into recession. To make matters worse, fuel prices skyrocketed in the 1970s, putting a final nail in the coffin, ensuring that fuel-thirsty hovercraft could never be widely adopted as transport. And it meant that the enormous SRN-4s would represent the pinnacle of passenger hovercraft design. But in the 1980s, they would face increasingly stiff competition from conventional ferries, which had wide enough profit margins to continually lower fares and win back customers. Giant hovercraft could no longer compete, especially after the Channel Tunnel opened in 1994. But no other vehicle can match a hovercraft's versatility, which is why these awesome machines remain relevant today with the world's militaries, industry, and rescue services. even as the iconic SRN-4s were entirely phased out by the year 2000. But many argue that hover technology never reached its full potential. And in the 1960s, Cockerell and British engineers had a much bigger vision for a new form of transport that would hover on a cushion of air and reach speeds of 500 kilometers an hour. They were called tracked hovercraft, and they would have been faster than any train in the world, even today. By 1972, engineers had developed the necessary technologies and even constructed a test track and prototype train. They were seemingly on the cusp of reinventing railways, but their efforts have almost entirely been forgotten. You can learn more about the incredible story of the tracked hovercraft in my latest video, available right now on Nebula. Nebula is where you can watch a growing number of never-released Mustard videos on obscure topics like the insane Soviet plan to develop flying aircraft carriers. It's a streaming platform where you can watch videos without advertisements from over 100 top educational creators who upload new kinds of smart content, not the cheap clickbait favored by YouTube's algorithm. But the best part about Nebula is that it's free when you sign up for CuriosityStream, a streaming service featuring thousands of award-winning documentaries. A recent favorite of mine is Machinery of War, a multi-episode series looking at iconic war machines used in modern history. For a limited time, get access to both Nebula and CuriosityStream for just 98 cents a month by going to curiositystream.com/mustard and use the promo code mustard when you sign up.